Hello there, and welcome back to The Piping Show, coming to you from the National Piping Centre in Glasgow. My name's Andrew Bova, and I have the great privilege to be your host this week. This week, I'm joined by Professor Josh Dickson. Josh is a good friend and colleague of mine. He used to be my PhD supervisor, the poor guy. And he is currently the head of traditional music at the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland. If you enjoy this content, please be sure to like and subscribe. It helps us out greatly. And if you're so inclined, please feel free to share it with your friends on social media. Now let's take a look at what's happening in the world of piping this week with Helen Urquhart.
The Competing Pipers Association, following their recent AGM, have announced a couple of changes to their executive committee. Lackey Dick will be taking over as the new secretary from Ross Miller, and Peter McAllister is the new vice president, taking over from Callum Beaumont. The Scottish Society of London have announced that entries are now open for their annual competition taking place on the 5th of November. You can head over to their website, scottishpipingsocietyoflondon.co.uk, to find out more about the event and enter. The National Piping Centre's junior gatherings return from the 17th to the 20th of October. The junior gatherings are a four-day teaching programme for pipers aged 17 and under. You can find out more over at our website about how to register. The Scotland on Tour live music events return to the Piping Centre this week. On Thursday the 22nd, Fiona Kennedy and friends will play live here. Then on Friday the 23rd, Ross Ainslie and Ali Hutton Trio will take to the stage. You can get tickets for these events at www.scotlandontour.com.
On last week's history, I mentioned that sometimes I rely on speaking to other people for their expertise. So now let's go to a slightly different history segment with myself and Professor Josh Dickson. Hello there. Joining me today for today's history segment is Professor Joshua Dickson. Josh is an expert on sort of older Pibroch settings, and I thought today we might take a look at Donald MacDonald's book, and you might be able to show some differences between this and what pipers might be familiar with today.
No problem at all. I'm gloved up.
Ah, indeed, yes.
Yeah.
Ready to go out murdering.
That's right. Exactly. We're all set.
Good.
So, this is great. I love the Donald MacDonald collection. I mean, that's the shorthand that we use for it. It's always the so-and-so collection. But this is actually called Ancient Martial Music of Caledonia. And one of the things, one of the many things that really distinguishes Donald MacDonald's collection from others is the really florid titles of the tunes. There's a lot to be gained in terms of one's historical knowledge, you know, the contexts of the tunes, just by reading the titles that Donald printed onto these pages. For instance, if it's the Pibroch of Donald Dhu or Shul Hamish Lament for King James VI, then there are lots of kind of historical information embedded within the titles and the subtitles for these tunes. And this is no exception. We're looking here at what today we know of as Lament for Patrick Og MacCrimmon. But in MacDonald's collection, which was published around about 1820, he referred to the tune in his collection as Lament on the Death of Patrick Moore MacCrimmon. Patrick Og's father. It really calls to mind the variability of tune titles in the Pibroch tradition. That's the result of oral tradition. Pibroch is an oral formulaic tradition in Scottish Gaelic culture. It was very much in keeping with mainstream musical cultures across Europe. One of the things that comes out of that is variability and what we call the pluralism of tune titles. It was a very pluralistic tradition in which many different names could be ascribed to the same tune, or indeed different tunes ascribed to the same title. Mm-hmm. So with this one, we have here Cúr Fadhc Mó Mhic Crimmin, Lament on the Death of Padraic Mór MacCrimmon. As distinct from Angus Mackay's collection in 1838, where Mackay and James Logan, the historian that collaborated with him on that collection, they had the whole history of the piping dynasties, including the MacCrimmons. And one of the anecdotes in Angus Mackay's collection was this the origin tale in folklore of Lament for Patrick Og, and that was the Patrick Og's pupil, Ian Dowell Mackay, blind John Mackay, had heard of the death of his tutor. Patrick Og composed this tune, then realized that it wasn't true. And when he next saw his old master, he played the tune for him, and Patrick Ogg thought, this is fantastic. Whereas, actually, in 1820, we see here in Donald MacDonald's collection a different name. This is on the death of Patrick Moore. And in fact, even earlier than that, in 1785, there's a handbill for the Highland Society of London's competition in Edinburgh, where the tune Lament for Patrick Moore, MacCrimmon, is listed as amongst the tunes that were played that day. So, folklore is a funny thing.
Indeed. Well, thanks for sharing that wee bit about the music here. If you're curious to have a look at this music yourself, Josh and I, later on in this episode, will be discussing a new resource available to you. So stay tuned.
Our little friend Chanter MacDuck is taking full advantage of all the COVID-19 restrictions being lifted. Let's see where they're at today. And now for my interview with Professor Joshua Dickson. For those of you who haven't had the pleasure of meeting Josh, he's originally from Alaska and is the head of the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland's traditional music program. He's also involved with a new project, the Pibroch Network, and for those of us in the academic piping community, is the Yoda of all things piping. Josh, thank you very much for coming and being with us today. It's great to see you.
My pleasure.
Always a treat. You know, there's this part of me that still misses coming in to see you every other week to go through my PhD and talk about all that.
That was all a pleasure. You know, it's a great thing to be able to get together and just talk about what we love and really get to grips with the materials that you had. You had some great ideas as a PhD candidate, and obviously that bore fruit.
Well, thank you very much. Speaking of the conservatoire, I'm very rarely there anymore. How are things at the conservatoire?
Fine, yeah, we're gearing up to the 2022-23 academic year. That's in a couple of weeks' time. So, yeah, we're just getting all the final bits and pieces together of the jigsaw puzzle or all the game pieces on the board. It's all getting there. So it's good. We're looking forward to a year of, you know, some interesting events taking place. We've got associate artists coming in. That's our answer to the whole artist in residence idea. We wanted to have an artist in residence scheme for quite a long time, and we're now in the middle of doing that. We welcomed Mike Vass last year for a 2-year residency. And then this is actually the really interesting thing about our particular scheme is that we're able, thankfully, to be able to have one associate artist for a 2-year period. And then in the middle of that, we get another associate artist to come in for another second year or 2-year residency. So actually, any given year, there are two associate artists in residence working with the students on a particular project, usually ending in something public. You know, it's just the whole idea is to be working with the students and expanding the horizons and so on. And so we had Mike Vass last year, that's continuing this year, and then Jennifer Wrigley is coming in.
Now you beat me in my question.
Yeah, well, there you go. So yeah, that's going to be great. So things are in full swing.
Well, that's great. I know that I've been speaking to John and preparations are underway. It starts, I think, well, at the time of recording, next week or the week after. So it's looming on the horizon.
That's right, end of the week.
but an exciting time for sure. Now, one of the parts of that RCS degree course, and I remember, I mean, years ago now, I interviewed you for the old podcast that Dan Nevins
That's
and I had,
right.
Chanter Banter.
That's right,
and
that's right.
You were talking about the Pibroch Pit. And yeah. is that still going?
Absolutely, absolutely. I like to think of that as a real success within the piping curriculum in the degree. So just for those who are not aware, the traditional music bachelor's degree has a formal offshoot, of course, a degree that kind of stems out from it that is particularly for pipers. So that's in itself kind of both an application and a symbol of the partnership between the National Piping Centre and the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland. That goes back 20 years or more at this point, so it's very strong. And so as part of that piping offshoot, that formal degree in piping that shares a lot with the wider traditional music degree, there are obviously some elements that are specific to piping within the what we call the supporting studies, the really hands-on performance-based, practice-based studies that take place both in the conservatoire and here in the National Piping Center. And so we wanted, as a curriculum, to be able to cover quite a wide range of ground when it comes to Kjellbeck light music and Kjellmore, Pibroch, as well as playing in ensembles, playing in band situations, Highland dancing, or let us say piping for Highland dancing, and further afield, looking at you know, the music of the Borders bagpipe, the small pipes, looking at the bellows pipe traditions, and many other things besides. And so the Pibroch pit was our answer to the need to have students kind of immerse themselves in the classical music of the Highland bagpipe in a way that was distinct from the other teaching and learning to do with light music. And so we like to cover enough ground so that students are not necessarily trained specifically for a career in competition piping, but we want to make sure that they're able to do that, that they have all the tools at their disposal and that they're trained to be able to do that effectively if that is what they want to do. So the end result is not someone who's going to be absolutely immersed in the competition field, but someone who definitely has all the skills to be able to do that if they want. But we find that there's a lot of artistic, there's a lot of creativity. There's a very wide range of artistic outcomes that come from the piping, both in the light music and in the Pibroch. So Pibroch pit is that deep well, that rich well of classical piping, where Willie McCallum and I both take the students at different levels. And it's all about becoming acquainted with, understanding, and performing repertoire and various styles associated with the repertoires and the collections that go back to 1760 with the treatise of Joseph MacDonald, all the way up to the, you know, the Book 16 of the Pibroch Society and lots of others in between. So in the first level of the Pibroch pit, for instance, Willie McCallum takes them, and it's very much about the 20th century. It's about the Pibroch Society collections, the Kilberry Book of Kilmore. It's really looking at modern stylistic performance practice on the competition platform and ensuring that they've consolidated their skills in that regard. They've got a good core of repertoire in today's predominant style. And then I take them in Pibroch pit for level two, where we go back in time and we go to, we immerse ourselves in the sources that go from, like I said, 1760 with the treatise of Joseph MacDonald up to the turn of the 20th century, C.S. Thomason's Kilmore, for instance. So some of the big collections that we look at and use as the basis of the studies would be, you know, all the usual suspects. So Donald MacDonald's collection, 1820-ish. The MacArthur-MacGregor collection around about the same time, Angus Mackay's collection of 1838, Donald McPhee's of 1876, William Ross, actually, the Queen's Piper after Angus Mackay, his collection from 1869. So it goes on up through the Glen collection and all the way up to Kilmore by Thomason. So that obviously is a big range of source material to look at, to be acquainted with. And so level two is really about students having consolidated their performance practice in modern stylistic practices. They go back in time and they actually start to encounter, well, what makes Pibroch the way it is, structurally, rhythmically, motivically? What do the early sources tell us? What is the actual range, stylistically, that we have available to us as performers, as knowledgeable pipers and musicians, knowledgeable of the tradition, that can expand beyond what one would hear on the competition platform? Not that that's a bad thing, but rather just we want students to be well-rounded and knowledgeable.
How do you, when you're looking at some of those older manuscripts, you know, especially ones from like, you know, the early 1800s and the mid 1800s, how do you think about what's written on the page and transform what's written on the page into a performance practice?
That's actually pretty intuitive. I mean, we all, as pipers, we do that all the time, but for those who are coming into the degree and they're predominantly fairly young, they're, you know, 18, 19 years old at that point, And they won't have as much experience looking through the older collections or being able to synthesize and what one might say triangulate amongst a range of sources to find something that they're comfortable with. They'll have more experience of, for instance, following their tutor's advice or instruction, command, whatever, and just saying, you know, they learn at their tutor's knee, and that's fine. But this is the point in their piping careers and their education and their training where we want to then set, let's say, half a dozen or a dozen different sources in front of them, in theory, and say, here's a tune. This tune is featured, there's a setting of this tune in X number of sources which you have here at your disposal. It's important, A, to know where these sources have come from, who compiled them, who edited them, and why, you know, who's their audience, and what do they tell us of the time in which they were made. And B, it's important for them to be able to grasp and put these sources into practice, as it were, to kind of absorb them into their active repertoire. So the idea is, for instance, they take a tune, like I said, and there's a setting of this tune in any number of different source materials. They've got them in front of them. And a task, typically, would be, all right, go to all these sources, systematically go through them for this particular tune, take your time, and figure out what you really enjoy, what speaks to you in each setting that you find in all these sources. So let's say there's half a dozen sources, collections from 1815 to 1880, something like that. And so they've got to find the tune in each of these sources. They've got to study them, get them under their fingers, really try them out on the practice chanter, on the pipes, sing them, use the Cantrach that they have, they've become acquainted with by that time. Really look in detail at the minutiae of the notations, because actually not all of them are used to doing that. They'll look at a particular ornament or an embellishment, and it'll look like to them at the split second it'll look like a grip, when in fact it's an idiri or something like that. So they've got to really look at the minutiae of it, the fine details, particularly with a lot of open fingerings in these earlier sources. And they've got to find out or determine for themselves what speaks to them. What do they really enjoy? What do they find that they like in each of these settings? And then, crucially, comes the synthesis. They've got to, or they're tasked with incorporating those choices into and construct for themselves a setting of the tune that incorporates all these various things that they like out of each of these settings. And so at a stroke, they have constructed a setting of a tune that is entirely unique to them. No one else on the planet will play that tune exactly that way at that moment. But at the same time, each and every single component of what they're playing is based on indisputable, impeccable, traditional source material. So the traditional parameters are there, but they've got to figure out how can they use this material for their own artistry.
It's great to get an inside look into how pipers doing the RCS degree course, you know, aren't just being trained to be top competitors, but are trained to be historically informed artists. I think that's something sometimes people not closely involved with the course might not see. Now, you're talking about all of these different sources that they're using, which I'll use as a segue to ask you about your new initiative, the Piebrich Network.
That's right. So
can you talk a little bit about the Piebrich Network, what it is, how it came about?
Sure. Well, what we're calling the Piebrich Network used to be called the Alt Piebrich Club. This is a website that began life in about 2013, and it was started by an American piper named David Hester. He was actually a biblical scholar and a scholar of rhetoric, but he was a lifelong piper. He had spent quite a few years away from piping, but he kind of gravitated back to it. And he wanted at that time to, he had discovered certain things that were online at that point, things like Willie Donaldson's Set Tunes series on the Pipes Drums website, which is a fantastic resource. And he recognized sources like this and new tools like this. And he wanted to create a website that kind of brought specifically the earliest source material, published and unpublished, in Pibroch together under the one website and easily accessible. He wanted to, you know, work in cooperation with other, what you might call stakeholders or other partners in the world of piping, the Pibroch Society, Kjell Shen, and others. And in particular, he went to Barney B. Brown, who some will know is a very active piper, kind of musical archaeologist of sorts, and currently a PhD candidate from Cambridge University. He taught at RCS for quite some time, and he's very much a specialist in early music and early instruments, and in Pibroch specifically. So David sought Barnaby out, and the two of them in 2013 essentially created this website, altpibroch.com. Now, the name made me cringe, and I don't think I was alone in that. The word alt just has that certain connotation that I just felt, you know, wasn't great. But in respect to David Hester, he wanted to have, just as the name suggests, an alternative to what he considered to be mainstream Pibroch narratives and moors and you know,
No, I mean, there's so many different ways that it's acceptable to play Pibroch today. You know, well, it's not narrow-minded ever.
Yeah, well, there you go. And, you know, so I'm, neither Barnaby nor I would suggest that his thinking in that regard was, you know, we don't necessarily subscribe to the point of view that there needed to be, that there was something to rebel against. But that was kind of his thinking at that time. Barnaby and I both saw a lot more traction in cooperation and complementarity and interdisciplinarity rather than, you know, setting something up that is in opposition to something else. So time went on, and actually, unfortunately, David passed away in 2019, and the site essentially lay dormant for about 2 years. Barnaby then, last year in 2021, put out a call to anyone who'd like to be able to help to revitalize this site and kind of make it, continue to make it relevant and make something of it. So, yeah, he and I got together. I was very happy and eager to get involved in any way that I could to help. And through a generous grant from the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland, just kind of internally within the institution, I was able to get a bit of funding, enough to kind of essentially pay for a project in which we would get the website just sort of redesigned, refreshed, I guess. And so that has led us to with the end of what we've called phase two. So that's included renaming, of course, redesigning the website pretty significantly. And that's not over yet. That redesign will continue into a phase three, but that's going to take a little bit longer. So at the minute, we're seeing now the outcome of phase two of what is now called the Pibroch Network. It used to be altpibroch.com, and now it's the Pibroch Network. And the idea, of course, was to call attention to the idea for collaboration, interdisciplinarity, complementarity, working with people, dialogue, all those things, the idea of a network. And, you know, Barnaby already had actually a domain called pibroch.net, so it just fit perfectly. So we just...
Is that the URL?
That is the URL,
pibroch.net. You heard it here first, folks, pibroch.net.
There you go, very easy.
well, I've clicked around the website a bit, and I mean, it's genuinely so rich with resources and different collections. I'd very much encourage anybody listening at home to spend some time on the website. And I'm aware that we're unfortunately coming to the end of our interview here, but I thought we'd have a little throwback to our PhD supervisions, well, I suppose my PhD supervisions with you, where we would often bookend talking about Star Wars. So, three trailers have just dropped, The Mandalorian Season 3, Andor, and Tales of the Jedi. What are you the most excited to see?
There's a lot to look forward to. So as you say, there's the Andor trailer. There is Tales of the Jedi. There's Mando season 3. All those things look pretty good. Bad Batch season 2.
Bad Batch season 2.
Bad Batch season 2. I do like the trailer that's on that. I especially appreciate the wee hip-hop thing at the end. You know, there's something kind of cops about that. You know, kind of 1980s stuff going on. There's a lot to look forward to there.
Between the Peabrick Network and all these upcoming Star Wars series, I'm sure that you and I will have plenty to chat about in the coming months.
It's not every PhD supervisor and supervisee who goes to watch Rogue One together.
That is true. That is very true.
That happened.
It breaks some of the undergrads' brains when I tell them that we did that. So listen, we'll have to call it there. But Josh, always a pleasure to have you. Thank you so much for coming. Be sure to go check out pbrick.net, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you for tuning in to another episode of The Piping Show. Remember, if you enjoyed what you saw here, go ahead and like and subscribe and share on social media. I'm Andrew Bova, and it's been my pleasure to host you this week. I'll play you out with a rendition of Alex C. McGregor. Mm-hmm.